Hi, I'm Jerry Barker, Vocational Specialist here in Orlando, and I'm here with Ali Frazier. And today we are going to go through the client buyer guest questions that you send into Ali on a regular basis, and she is going to ask me those questions, and I am going to answer them for you. Ali, hi, how are you?
Great. Are you ready?
You got some tough ones for me today?
I've got some good ones.
All righty. I like the good ones. So anyway, what's our first question? Who's it from, and what's going on?
Our first question is from Richard in England, and he asked, which I know many people are wanting to know, how is the market today?
The market today. Richard in England. How are you doing, Richard, over there in England? The market today, it's a great question, and the market changes a lot, obviously. It's been a really, really, really unusual year. If you've been following the vacation home market from the beginning of this year, even from last year when it was really quiet, it's gone almost 180 degrees from being quiet to just crazy busy. It's starting to taper off a little bit now. We normally see that, our normal cycle, for those folks who don't know, the vacation home market's kind of unique. It actually goes through a seasonal scenario. Beginning of the year is usually crazy. People are coming here, so they tend to buy to come for the summer. So usually February, March, April are busiest years. And then as we go into the summer, you have a lot of people coming in during their trip here during the summer, and then they're looking for a vacation home. And then when we get out the end of the summer, people are heading back to school and business, etc., etc. Vacation homes tend to quieten down a little bit. But interestingly enough, that is when sellers, after they've gotten all the great revenue from the summer bookings, that's when the sellers decide to sell. So it's interesting, because once you get out of that second week in August and you move into September, you start seeing the inventory rising back up again. You have less buyers, you have more inventory, prices start to come down. And we're actually starting to see that a little bit in this year. Right now, we're coming towards the end of August. We're almost in it, September 2021, for those of you watching this video in 5 years' time. So you've got a time reference of the current scenario and where we're at. And we are starting to see it come back a little bit. It's been a crazy market. Properties have probably gone up across the board. What would you say, Ali? 20% probably, as much as that. And a lot of the resales are going up. New homes, almost impossible to get one. Waiting lists for new homes right across the board, those have gone up in price as well. So it's been a very robust market. Great if you own a property. You've seen some great appreciation over the last 6 to 8 months. Good time to buy right now, especially for you folks over there in the UK. You will understand this, Richard, as well as just about anyone. We have, and Ali will back me up in this one because she takes all the calls and gets all the emails. We must have 100 people in our client list who are desperate to get here to come visit us and look at properties and just can't get out of the UK. So what is going to happen is there's going to be a situation where the airports are going to open up and we're going to have people from all over the world pouring into Orlando, and that's again going to put a lot of stress on the inventory in the system. So there is a little bit of a gap right now, the end of the domestic buyers at the end of the summers and a little bit before the Europeans and internationals start to come. I would say between now probably, and it's hard to guess, not knowing when the airports are going to open up, I would probably suggest sometime between now and the end of the year is probably a really, really good time if you're looking for a vacation home here in Orlando. How's that?
Very good. Good. Really good. Adding on to that, I had another question from another of our Brit clients, James, from England, and to add on to the market update, he asked specifically, how is COVID affecting rentals? Not so much the buying, but the renting.
Yeah, fascinating. It's if you take away everything else, you're just looking at it in an interesting scenario, not interesting about COVID, but it really has made a lot of changes to the market, as you can imagine. The thing that I think that's been most amazing to us is how busy it's been, both in the real estate and the rentals. In fact, a lot of people last year were discounting selling their properties because they didn't think they were going to have any people coming here. But it's actually been the other way around about. A lot of people have decided that instead of being stuck in a house in the middle of nowhere or a busy suburb or a city or whatever, getting a property here in Orlando is actually a really good investment, and it's really driven the market. And COVID, ironically, has been really good for sales And it's also been exceptionally good for rentals. All of our clients are telling us that they're experiencing a record year in rentals. So, and of course that pushes up because a lot of people need that revenue to pay for the property. So we're seeing the market actually appreciating because of COVID. Will it start to go down as COVID starts to regress? Hard to know, but we certainly have a very robust market right now. And I think we'll all probably agree that COVID's not going to disappear anytime soon. So if it carries on the trend it's been carrying on since the beginning of the year, COVID has actually affected the real estate market, certainly the short-term rental real estate market in Orlando. It's been actually a positive, strangely enough.
Mm-hmm. And I know that this question is a little bit crystal ball, but Ken from England was one of a few that asked, we've seen the prices increasing this year steadily. Do you think they're going to stabilize? Are they going to crash? Are they going to, you know, continue to go up? I know it's a crystal ball question, but, you know, adding on to the market update, any thoughts?
Love the crystal ball questions.
You know, we'll always get them.
Well, crystal ball is really what it is you're asking somebody that deals with it on a day-to-day basis what their opinion is, and that's really what our crystal ball is. And this is all we do in the team here at Jerry Barker Group on a daily basis. We follow the market, we help buyers buy property, we help sellers sell property, and we see the market trends. I've been doing this for a long time, and fortunately I have a lot of data now in my head of being able to see when things start to change. So I get a pretty good handle on what's happening. My personal feeling is right now we've probably reached a plateau in terms of price. We've had a really solid period of appreciation over the last 6 to 8 months. They're really at a point. Personally, I think the vacation home properties are actually at a place where they should have been a long time ago. I've always felt that the properties here in the vacation home resort area in Orlando are actually always been undervalued. And I think what we've actually seen is a very drastic realignment. And today, I feel as though the prices are where they probably should have been all along. And there's been a lot of reasons for that, and we can dig into that. I'm happy if you want to give me a call or reach out to me personally. I can go into the back end of that. I've got some pretty strong information that backs all that up. But a lot of it is to do, especially with the British market, and when Britain, Brexit left Europe, it created a very unusual market stall here in Orlando, because I think the Brits probably made up about 25% of the buyer's market here. And with Brexit and the devaluation of the pound and everything that went with that, it caused it to stagnate the market. So I think, me personally, I think this price hike, let's call it that, has been in direct relation to the prices basically staying the same for about the last 4 or 5 years. So it's the realignment that's happened isn't pushing the properties higher than they probably should be. I think it's actually taking them to where they should actually have been. And I think now it's probably settled. And if anything, generally markets tend to overcompensate one way and then they overcompensate the other way. And I think we're maybe just a little overcompensated. And I think possibly they'll start creeping back down again. But here's the other side of that coin, is that there are still a lot of people waiting to buy a property here, have been trying to get one for the last 4 or 5 months and haven't been able to get a property because there's been such a chase for those properties. So there's still a backlog of people which are holding the market up. And how long they hold that market up until the Europeans get in, and you have this period of time, where does that match? Because when the Europeans and internationals get here, it's going to push it again. So that kind of goes back to our last question. I think we're in an interesting little period right now, probably until the end of 2021 at least. I think this is a good time to jump into the market if you're considering buying.
Great, thank you. So we get this question a lot. Mike from New Jersey. How do I find the best house in the best resort or with the highest rentals?
Ooh.
The silver bullet question.
Yeah, that's
and we get it a lot, and you know, quite rightly so.
There's a funny I tell people, and people always call me up, and I want a really good property, and I want a really good deal, etc., etc. And I tell them, I say, I've never in the history of doing this job, I've never had someone call me up and say, Jerry, I want a really bad deal. So it's fair a enough. Very common question. Can you get me the best house and the best resort and the best blah, blah, blah? The answer to that question is probably a little bit more complex than just simply yes. The answer to that question is it depends. It depends as you as a buyer. And everybody's different. Everybody's needs are different. One of the things that I always find amazing is the spectrum of buyers and what their priorities are. And no more so it stands out is when we get investor buyers coming in, because investor buyers only see how much it rents and how much revenue it generates. And one of the questions that investor buyers always ask is, can you get me the historical numbers on this property? And they just perceive it that everybody else is looking to invest. So when you get them the rental numbers, and the rental numbers aren't particularly good, they think it's a bad house or whatever it may be. Chances are, believe it or not, more than 60% of our clients aren't in it for making as much money as they can. They'd like to make some money, help cover costs and ownership, et cetera, et cetera. But it's one of those things that when people say, get me a really good home and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, it's a variable. It depends on so much. So to answer the question precisely, it depends. The answer is what an individual is looking for in a property. Is there a specific? Well, yes, there are. And I think that's where you need to find a vacation home specialist, somebody that knows all the resorts, knows all the locations and all the resorts. But more importantly, to talk to a specialist like myself, or Ali or Roger, and chat to us about what your needs are. Is it more personal? Is it more financial? Is it a balance of both? Where does it sit in the spectrum? And then we can go through all that. And that's really what we are experts at, is going through all those various parts, coming up with an answer. And strangely enough, there may be 50,000 vacation homes in Orlando, but if you do your job right and you break them down and you ask the right questions, you usually come down to only half a dozen really suitable potential properties that fit exactly what you're trying to do. So the answer to the question is really quite simple. There is no answer to the question. It really depends on you and what you're trying to achieve, and we'll go through that. Yes, there are places that do better than other places, but in saying that, there are places that do better than other places on the different levels. So again, it depends. But what we can tell you is, if we do the diligence right and you give us all the information that we need and we can digest all that for you, then we can put all that together and certainly suggest the best properties potential for what you're trying to do.
Great. Really great. There's so many scenarios that work here.
Every time. Everybody's different. There are, and I don't know how many homes we've sold by now, hundreds, maybe even thousands. And everyone's different. Every buyer, every situation, every single situation that we deal with is different. You just got to remember that you're different. So make sure that you're treated that way. You're just not, hey, here's a property, go buy it. We'll make sure we find the right one for you.
Great. So Ben from Arizona asked, he sees there's lots of homes, there's lots of resorts, and there are more being built. His question was really, do you think it's getting near saturation? Or at what point will it feel saturated? Or is there still room to grow?
Ben, that is a great, great question. Saturation point. I had this conversation actually yesterday with an investor client, and they'd spent a lot of time looking, and they had seen how many properties had come on the market, new resorts, etc., etc. Here's what you're going to find out. It's almost like, you know that game where you put the quarter in the slot and it goes down and it knocks a bunch more quarters off the bottom? I don't know what they call that, the slide or something. Vacation homes are a little bit like that. What actually happens is that a new resort comes online, it's got 800 or 900 or 1,000 homes, and they build those homes up, and you find all of the old resorts and all the communities at the bottom, they kind of drop off the resort list and become residential properties. And we see that an awful lot. We see that a lot of the older homes, maybe not so much the older resorts, but certainly a lot of the communities that do short-term rental, you see them turning more and more into residentials. So is the market getting too many properties in it, is maybe so. I think we've actually reached a point, because we had an expansion then of about 5 or 6 brand new resorts come up over the last 6 or 7 years, and they added a lot of new inventory into the marketplace. And those are, for the most part, almost completed now. There's only a couple of places where you can buy a new property, and Windsor Islands Resort is actually the only new one, and even that's now a year and a half old. So not only do we know that, but we also know that the developers are not building new resorts. And at one time we had 6 going at the one time. We've probably got 3 right now, and 2 of them are kind of the very last of it. So to go back to the original analogy, really what you see is the new, better, greater facilities and homes and floor plans just pushing out the ones at the bottom. So it probably stays just about the same. But interesting fact, probably not a lot of people know this, is that More and more every year, more people stay in vacation homes than they do in hotels. We know that statistically. So what's happening is we're needing more vacation homes because people realize that, you know, having a beautiful vacation home with a games room and your own pool, and it's not $100 for breakfast every day, is actually a better deal than getting a, you know, a $300 a night condo in Disney or wherever the case may be. And we just know factually that more people spend time in vacation homes every single year. So we do actually need to add on inventory onto that. So, but it's a fantastic question. It's one of my favorite topics to talk about. So was that Ben? Ben in Arizona?
Yes.
Ben in Arizona. I love that one.
Okay. Todd from Indiana.
Todd from Indiana. Okay.
His question was, how do I manage taxes and HOA fees when I'm not there?
Taxes and HOA fees when you are not there. Well, first of all, your annual taxes are going to be sent. Are we talking about annual property taxes, or are we talking about
annual property taxes?
Annual property taxes. So with annual property taxes, they will be billed to your home. When you buy a property, it's going to be deeded directly to your home. So your name's on it, and it won't be your vacation home address. It'll actually be wherever you live address. And annually, you'll be just delivered that from the county in Florida, and that will come directly to you, and you just write a check and pay it. So that's easy enough. Homeowners association fees are generally paid through direct debit. So you just have that, you'd set up a bank account and have that directly debited, whether it's monthly or quarterly or whatever the case may be. Nearly everything, as far as fees are concerned, a lot of them are covered through your property management company. They'll deal with some stuff. For example, they'll do the power bills and what have you. Sometimes they'll do that. Sometimes you can do that yourself. It's really up to you. There's some things you can do, some things you can let them do. That's a great question when we get into the whole situation of once you go under contract, we can sit down and say which areas do you want the management company to handle, and which areas are you going to handle yourself. Everybody's a little bit different. Some of them, a lot of the fees, for example, with the big resorts, the cable, the TV, that sort of stuff, are all rolled into your homeowner association fees. So you just set up a direct debit for that, and that all gets paid for you. But that's actually one of the easier things to handle. It's not a particularly complicated part of the scenario is the fees.
And talking of taxes, Fred from Tennessee asked specifically about what are the CDD taxes?
Yeah, so CDD is not specifically a tax. It's actually calculated. And so when you look at a listing and you see the scenarios, and then you see the taxes, taxes may or may not include a CDD. So what does that mean, they may or may not? Well, one of the things when developers go to the county to build a new resort, and it's one of the things the counties love because, you know, they're putting up houses and they're bringing in tourism, etc. So the counties love new resorts going up. One of the things that they do agree to do for the developers is put the infrastructure in. In other words, the streets and the roads and the lighting and the sewerage, etc., etc. So the county actually agrees to do that, and as you can appreciate, that costs a considerable amount of money. It saves the developer from spending that money, so theoretically they can offer you a better price on a new home. The consequence on the back end of that is the county is going to want their money back. So what they basically do is they're lending that money out to the new buyers, and a CDD is basically a payment back over a period of time, usually a 30-year bond, and the owner or owners of a particular property will pay that, and it's included in your annual tax. The CDDs. You'll find CDDs nearly always in the big new resorts, you know, the Champions Gates and the Windsor Islands and the Windsor West Sides. There'll be a CDD included generally in the big resorts, not so much in the smaller communities, etc., or the older resorts. They tend not to have the CDDs. So it's when you see the tax number, you may see that you'll see a number that says it's $6,000. It's probably $4,000. And the tax and $2,000 and the CDD, where it's all included in that one number. Although you may also see listed a CDD fee, which shows separately. It's not an addition. It's actually already included in the tax number. So that's a kind of good thing. Good question. Good questions. Great questions.
Super good questions.
Yeah.
So the CDD, does it expire at some point? If you buy new and it's with a CDD, at some point in the resale of the resale of the resale, will that owner not have to do a CDD? It does end.
Yeah, so at some point along the way, the 30-year bond will come up, and it's just like it's like a mortgage payment. You're paying back the county, and at some point it expires. It's usually a 30-year bond. Most people are not going to have a vacation home for 30 years, so and I don't even know. We're not at the stage right now. I think the oldest properties that we have right now in resorts are probably 20, 22, 23. As far as the CDDs are concerned, I'm probably thinking 10 or 11, 12 years are probably the first CDDs. I might be wrong in that by a little bit here and there, but give or take. So none of the CDDs are likely to expire in any of the new resorts, probably for at least another 15 years, I would say, or more. Mm-hmm. So it's just part of what you pay. It is what it is. Yep.
Added into the taxes.
Yep.
So, okay, AJ from Canada, had two scenarios going when he was chatting to us. Do I buy new in a new resort, or do I buy new in an established resort? Because we do have both scenarios in play.
Yep. No, it's interesting. Good luck buying anything new right now. There's a waiting list as long as my arm for new homes. So if you can get one, interesting. You know, I would probably suggest that's on a one-on-one basis. I would probably suggest that having a look and seeing what's available in both scenarios. Generally, certainly with the new resorts, if you're in early enough, you usually get a better pricing and you can be closer to the clubhouse and facilities, something like that. As the resorts tend to get closer to the completion, the properties tend to be further away, and prices tend to have been extended as far as they're likely to be by the end of it. So I would usually say try and get in early in a new resort. The downside of that is a lot of the times then the facilities aren't finished. So you have a little bit of a period of time where you might not get quite the benefit and returns until the facilities get done. So it's one of those kind of way off. Personally, I would rather go for a new resort and get in there early and get a good location, etc. But it's a really depends question, because you could find you get a really good deal, a really nice unit, and they're right ready to go with all the infrastructure and amenities all already created, and that may be what you're looking for. If you don't mind holding off for a few months until everything gets finished up, then you absolutely get a kick. There's no doubt that with the new homes and the new resorts, everybody likes new, and they all want to rush to the newer. You'll definitely get a little bit extra boost financially in terms of the rental rate, etc. from the brand new resort. So the answer is there's not an answer. It can go either way. You can look at it in a whatever the situation is at any given time. But I don't think there is any real absolute answer one way or another. But it's a good question. It's interesting. Yeah.
I think it would be helpful if you talked about a little market update on brand new homes right now. We didn't touch on that.
Yep.
But so really the question probably is, how do I buy a brand new home today?
Yeah. Everybody wants to know the answer to that. Right now, as it stands right now, the inventory is just crazy. There's nothing available. We have a waiting list. I'm very fortunate that I've been building new homes here for a long time. I know all the salespeople, I know all the new locations, and I know what's going on. And I'm probably one of the very few fortunates that can make a call. And for the most part, we generally can get our client a property. But it's not easy. Nearly all of the builders right now, everything is on a waiting list. And the unfortunate part about that is you don't have the time to go through the whole process. You're basically going to, if I can get you on the list and I can get you a property, and I might put three or four clients on that list at any given time, I may get a call from one of the sales directors and saying, "Hey, Jerry, I've got a 6-bedroom that fits this profile for this client. It's $650,000 in lot 1, 2, 3, 4. Do they want it?" And I have to call you up and say, "I got this lot and I've got this price. Do you want it?" And you can almost have to make a decision here and there right then. Hopefully, we've had a lot of conversations before that. We've talked about the resort and all the bits that go with it, and you don't have any questions and you're ready to move if it's suitable. But if you say no, they just pick up the phone to the next broker or the next buyer, and it just moves straight along. It's a little, I don't want to do it that way. The clients don't want to do it that way. The builders don't want to do it that way. But the market has just been so tight for new homes right now. And I'm really, really hoping that it eases off a little bit so we get a little bit more of a break on that. But to be quite honest, for everything I'm seeing and hearing right now, I'm not seeing that changing anytime soon. Maybe a little bit, but if you're looking for a new home, first of all, make sure you do all your research. Talk to us or whomever you're working with and make sure you ask all the questions, because the chances are you're going to have a year, nay, and an hour to make a decision. You don't want to be going, well, you know, how much is this or how much is that, or can I do this or can I do that or whatever. All those questions, get them out up front so that when you get that call, you can say, yeah, I'm ready to go. You're pre-approved. You've got your... They won't even talk to me unless I have proof of funds or a pre-approval. All that has to be done in advance, because if we don't, they're not even want to talk to those clients. So get ready, get prepared, ask all your questions. It's definitely the way to go, I think. Buying a new property is fun, it's great, it's fantastic. But it's just unusual times right now, and it's probably not going to change anytime in the near future.
No, that's a good update, though. Thank you, Jerry.
Sure.
That sort of answered Kamal's question. Kamal from Canada had asked, is it better to buy new or... like a couple of years old, like looking at sort of a 2020, 2019 property,
yep,
which has still got a lot of life in it, or hold out for new, which we know is not easy at the moment.
I'd do both. I would hedge your bets. I would be keeping an eye open, because a lot of these resorts are so new that you're looking at properties that are only a couple of years old and they're still in great shape. And you can still get great deals there. It's certainly easier with a resale that's already furnished. But then again, it's already furnished, so you don't get to do it the way you want, and you might have to change and wear and tear, etc. So there's a kind of little bit of a balancing going on there. But I don't think there's any particular real answer to that. I would probably suggest, if you were in the market, get on the waiting list for the new. And that's one of the things that we do right now. We have clients who are on the waiting list for the new, but at the same time, we have them on automated search criteria programs that are keeping them updated and everything that's coming on the market right now. And if something pops up that's a couple of years old and it fits all the criteria, then be prepared to jump in there. But you've got to be really aggressive, unfortunately. That's just the way it is, because everybody's dealing with the same situation. But the answer, in my opinion, is both. If you don't mind one way or another, if you don't have a preference one way or another, then there's no reason why we can't do both.
Yep.
Yep.
Okay, both good. Jason from New York said, looking at the themed rooms in a lot of the resales, and when you look at the model homes with the theme rooms, do features like themed rooms really make a difference to the rental income?
Yeah, I believe so. It's a great theme room question. The one thing that I would say about theme rooms generally, when I start talking about them, is make them gender neutral. Because one thing you do, if you do all princesses, then you know a bunch of boys don't want to come and stay in a princess house. So I think theme rooms are great. I think minimalizing. I'm building a house right now. I'm building a brand new house in Windsor Island. And I actually, my daughter, I have a 16-year-old daughter. And I said to her, what do you want to do for theme rooms? And she came up with some really interesting Minecraft, strangely enough, is what she wants to do. That's gender neutral. Everybody loves Minecraft. We're doing an obligatory Mickey room, because you kind of have to. You don't have to, but we're doing that anyway. And my daughter also loves theatre and Broadway, so we're doing a Broadway room that's going to be a kind of musical theme. So we actually left up to her, weirdly as it might be, to make those themes. But it's very light, because anybody can stay in a Broadway room. Emily can stay at a Minecraft room. And I'd probably also go to suggest that most people wouldn't mind staying in the Mickey room either. So to me, that's the key, is keeping it gender neutral. I think that's very light. I don't think it's really overly done and heavy. But it depends. If you're going to build one of those multi-million dollar houses that we build in likes of Reunion, and people are spending $2,000 a night, then they want the mega, super, duper, completely themed out, crazy heavy stuff. That's just what people are wanting if they're spending that kind of money. But yeah, to answer the question directly, themed rooms, I do believe. Think about it this way. If you all are sitting, deciding on your holiday for 2022, and the kids are around the computer, and everybody's looking at pictures, and you're looking through vacation homes, and your 10 or 11 or 12-year-olds are looking, and all of a sudden they see Marvel, or they see, that's the one I want, or Batman, or Spider-Man, whatever's on the go, and that's what they fall in love with. Let me tell you, that's what mum and dad are going to get, providing obviously everything else is equal. So it jumps out, and it definitely gives you a leg up You know, dad's going to want one thing, mom's going to want another thing. But the kids, at the end of the day, you're coming to Orlando generally for the kids, and they're going to want the theme rooms, and the theme rooms pop out and makes yours different from the one next door, and you're getting the booking and they're not. I think that's just common sense. So yeah, theme rooms for sure. I'm doing them, and I've had several vacation homes, many clients with theme rooms that do really well. So theme rooms, but generally don't overdo it.
Great. Okay. Lorna from England asked a question, completely different subject. She asks, what are the first steps I should take as a foreign national looking to buy?
Yeah. First steps you should take, obviously, are we talking just about the general overview, looking for property? You know, do your diligence, start your own diligence. Our website is fantastic. Go to jerrybarker.com. One of the things that we have tried really hard to do over the last decade or whatnot is to really create an educational website. And I would argue that there isn't anything you can't find on our website for any answer, any question, even if it's one of these videos or a page that's very specific to it. And I designed and built all that myself. That's what I used to do before I did real estate. So it's really easy for me to do that and create all that content. And it's kept up to date and it's particularly accurate. So do your diligence first. The first thing you want to do is start your diligence and then find someone that you can trust. And I think that's really important. There are thousands of realtors and vacation home people here, and unfortunately not all of them have the knowledge and expertise that you're going to need to get through this whole program, especially if you're a foreign national, because there's a lot of extra things that you have to do and deal with as a foreign national that you don't have to as a domestic. And you're obviously 3,000 or 4,000 miles away as well. So it's really important that you have someone here that's telling you actually what's going on and not just trying to sell your property and move to the next one. We are a very niche, very small brokerage. So that's what we've always tried to do, is really educate our clients, be completely transparent, let them understand all the things you do. To me, that's first, is find someone you can trust. And hey, talk to everybody, call them all up, ask them all the questions, ask all these questions, see what answers you get, find out who knows about all of the things we've talked about today. Do that, because those come up and you need somebody that can deal with it. That's as far as getting started. As far as the process is concerned, probably the very first thing that you'll need to address is how you're going to pay for it. If you happen to have cash, then obviously that's not a problem, but not everybody has, you know, $300,000 or $500,000 or $600,000 in cash lying around, whether it's dollars or pounds or whatever the case may be. So if you're doing financing, that's number one. You want to make sure you get that sorted out, and we know what the budget is. So we can help you with that. We can introduce you to some absolutely great financial people. So that's probably first on the list once you get beyond the initial kind of investigative part. And okay, this is something I can handle. What comes next? Financing is next. If we feel as though the financing is going to happen, then there's a kind of string of different things that are important. But as far as the technical stuff is concerned, there are things like getting yourself an ITIN number, which is part of the process. You're going to need one of those. It's basically a social security number for America. We can help you with that as well. There's a lot of those little things that we want to get started off as early as possible. They're not particularly expensive, but they do take time because it's paperwork and sending stuff all over the place. So getting you prepared and ready to buy a property here is really important. Introducing you to the various vendors that's going to help you, like property management companies or furniture people or whatever it might be, to help you with all those parts. So getting that, basically your team, that's what you want to do. You want to take your team. We consider ourselves the quarterback, so we're going to help you put all your team together, and we're going to introduce you to a couple of each different and make sure you got that team. Meanwhile, while we're doing that, you are looking at properties, and we're talking, like we have earlier on, about where we should buy, what's important to you. Is it money? Is it location? Family? All that stuff is really important. Whittling that down. So it's kind of, we call it a roadmap, and you start off at the beginning of the roadmap and you go through all the progressions, and if you get to the end, you know, we meet you at your vacation home for a frosty libation and a cheerful event out by the pool. And I said this to many people, it's by far my favorite part, is meeting people who have lifetime ambition is to buy a vacation home here in Orlando and to live the dream that I've been fortunate enough to live. And that to me, I think, is getting on that roadmap. And then we'll progress you down. You don't have to worry about what I do next. We'll help you each part of the stage, introduce you to the right people, get you where you need to be. And then it actually becomes a lot of fun. You don't have to worry about what to do about insurance or, you know, We got all that for you. Ali has a list that's about this long, and it's checkpoints, and you will go through every single one of those checkpoints. And if you don't have a checkpoint, she's going to be on your case nonstop till you get it. You're going to get your insurance, get your insurance, get your insurance. Am I right?
You are right. It's a good checklist, though.
It's a great checklist. Yes, it is the best checklist in the whole of the industry because we created it. Took us a long time to get it exact, but we missed nothing. So you will miss nothing.
Great. That is all our questions for
today.
Wow,
there we go. We have done client questions. That was a good lot. That's some great questions in that one.
Smart clients.
Yeah, we got smart clients. You see, that's what happens when you educate people. They get smarter. They're already smart, and then they get even smarter. So thank you very much, everybody that sent us in a question for this show. You can find us at www.jerrybarker.com. Make sure that you get a copy of this. This is my book, The Orlando Vacation Home Buyer's Guide, right over here. It is free. You can go to my website, www.jerrybarker.com/guide. You'll find it on the front page anyway. You just put your email address in and I'll send you a link to download a digital copy. If you're here in Orlando, I have a bunch of these books. I'm happy to give you one. They're a great read. It takes about 30 minutes, probably 40 minutes to read it. And this will tell you just about everything you need to know about buying a vacation home here in Orlando. It's an absolute must. So once again, thank you very much for watching. Please join our YouTube channel so you get updates on all the latest videos. I produce videos, just did one yesterday for you international buyers on ITIN numbers, LLCs, taxes, all that great stuff with Simon Howell here. And we did a fantastic video with him. So make sure you check out all the little bit something and everything. So make sure you are on our YouTube channel, get subscribed to that and you'll get the latest updates. And you can contact us anytime. Chances are you'll get to meet Ali to begin with. And then hopefully I will get to meet you personally. But if you've got any questions or you're looking to buy a vacation home in Orlando, then this is the book you should start with. And this is the lady you need to start talking with. Right, Ali?
That's it.
From Ali and I here in beautiful, sunny Orlando, wherever you are in the world, I wish you a good morning, a good afternoon, a good evening, or a good night. Stay safe.